Our dad, Henry, spent his childhood in Southern California with his parents, Susanna and Richard, and four siblings, Roger, Sue, Sarah, and Mary. Several generations of his mother's ancestors, since the 1840s, had been sheep ranchers and orange farmers with huge ranches. As a boy, he walked tiptoe with his caped and powerful imaginary friends, Killer, Capture, and Catcher. His father, Richard, was a Republican, engineer, and outdoorsman. His mother, Susanna, a Democrat and author, cherished our dad's imagination and started his lifelong love of typesetting and fonts. He was especially close with his sister, Sarah. He experienced his first of several family tragedies when she took her life during college at Radcliffe in 1961. More tragedy followed as Susanna and Richard, along with sibling Roger and family, died suddenly in a plane crash in 1966. Less than 5 years later, in a turn too cruel for fiction, Dad's first wife, Judith Clark, died in a car accident. When Dad met my mom in 1972 at our family property at Leonard Lake, I wonder if he sensed that his ever-shrinking family was about to get larger. They married in 1973 in San Francisco with an intimate family ceremony. Dad caught his bride lovingly in picture after picture. I, Adriana, was born the next year, and Dad became a dad. I remember lying in my bunk bed with my sister Rose below as Dad passed out his magic peanuts through storytelling. As I tasted the imaginary squishy peanuts, we were transported to exotic places and imbued with special powers. I can still taste these peanuts. They remind me of Dad's playful, imaginative mind. My sister Rose remembers.
I remember when I was about 5, learning some new words. We would make them up by adding itating to the end of an adjective. So we had yuccitating, siccitating, and grossitating. Dad really enjoyed overhearing us and started adding them to his vocabulary. So even 25 years later, he would look at a plate of asparagus and say, "That's succotating," while also reminding everyone at the dinner table that the chicken was a dead animal.
I don't know if Dad was still passing out magic peanuts when Julia came around, or if he thought that perhaps she needed a different kind of training to deal with the world. Julia says,
"Dad wanted me to be really tough and assertive, so we had this game where he'd stick out his arm and say, 'Let's see how hard you can hit me.' So I'd hit him as hard as I could a few times and he'd say, 'That doesn't hurt at all. Can't you hit me any harder?' He never flinched, and I'm not really sure how he did that."
Even without magic peanuts, our brother David was developing a creative and inquisitive individualism that reflected Dad's influence. My sisters and I all attended the San Francisco Waldorf School started by Mom and Dad. Our school life was filled with handmade main lesson books, and our summers glowed with adventures in the forest at Leonard Lake. As our family grew, Dad presided over a unique office building at 3220 Sacramento Street. There he recognized and nurtured the creativity and ideas of those around him, trading the magic peanuts of our bedtime stories for cutting-edge Apple computers. It was sometimes a struggle to pry Dad away from work, where he was in earthly paradise. His satisfaction rose immensely when he brought satellite internet to life at Leonard Lake. The same month that my baby Gwendolyn was born, Mom and Dad moved to Ukiah to be close to me. It's been so good to be together in one town, close to Leonard Lake, the magnetic place that pulled us here to begin with. In his short time in Ukiah, Dad left his mark with his energy and generosity. He helped publish a book and papered the town with handsome posters to promote events at the Mendocino Environmental Center and other organizations. Alongside his industrious public life, Dad's inner child was never far from the surface with his grandchildren. His magic bubbled up as a look of mischievous delight. I feel Dad's presence every day in my communications work, in our network of friends, in my mom, in my siblings, and in my daughter. A life well lived continues to reverberate. My brother David puts it this way.
A lot of the projects that I'm involved in and interests that I have and things I've been studying are pretty similar to Henry, what he was doing. Like, I look on my bookshelf, I was looking on his bookshelf, and there's so many similar books and things that I'm, you know, that we were studying. His intentions, his DNA, or whatever, is still carrying on through us, even though he's no longer physically active in it.
And I think, what stories do we want to pass down to the grandchildren who won't remember much about him? We will want them to remember their heritage and to know that even the greatest tragedies can be overcome. We will want them to remember Dad's generosity, creativity, and industriousness. What would he want them to be? He'd want them to be forward-thinking, open-minded, and never dismissive of an idea because it seems crazy to others. He would want them to experiment and always have the tools around them to realize their dreams. Finally, he would want them to be whimsical and silly as they enjoy themselves doing whatever they want. What an impression our dad and Grampy has made on our lives.
Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away.